Hello everyone, in this video we will cover the section 4.4. In this section we will see coordinate systems of vector spaces. We will follow the handwritten lecture note for this section, the coordinate systems, the section 4.4. First we will see a theorem called unique representation theorem. Let beta be a basis for a vector space bigger V, including the vectors b1, b2, blah blah, bn. We have n vectors in this basis. Then for each vector x, all vectors in the vector space actually, there exists a unique set of scalars c1, c2, c3, blah blah, cn, such that X is a linear combination of the vectors in the basis with weights with scalars c1, c2, blah blah, cn. Okay, we have a unique representation for every vector in the vector space V, every vector X, as a linear combination of the vectors in the basis. Okay, this is a unique representation for every vector. There is no another representation in terms of the vectors in the basis for the vector x. Therefore we say this theorem as a unique representation theorem. So using this theorem we obtain an important result, which is given as a definition here. Suppose beta is a basis for the vector space and the vector x is in this space. So the coordinates of x relative to the basis beta, or we say beta coordinates of x are the weights c1, c2, blah blah, cn, such that x is the linear combination of them. X has a representation obtained from the unique representation theorem written here. Okay. Namely, when we talk about the coordinates of a vector or components, we will interest in the weights of the linear combination written here for a vector x in the vector space generally. If c1, c2, c3, blah blah, cn are the beta coordinates of x, then it is denoted by x beta, this symbol, and we use the matrix representation also for the beta coordinates of x. You see this one. So this is the coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta, or the b coordinate vector of x. We have two things to say this situation. The first one, we can say sometimes the coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta. The second thing is to say that this is the b coordinate vector of x, b coordinate vector of x. Okay, and we can create a mapping and transformation from x to its coordinate vector relative to the basis beta, and it is called the coordinate mapping determined by the basis beta. Okay, so when we talk about the coordinates of x or components or b coordinates of x, so we will look at the weights of the linear combination. Okay, the coefficients of the vectors on the right hand side will be the coordinates of x, beta coordinates of x. If we change the basis for the vector space, or if we take another basis for the vector space, of course the coordinates of the vector x also will change. Okay, we will see in next examples this situation. So for example, the entries in the vector x has the components 1 and 6 are the coordinates of x relative to the standard basis e1, e2 in R square. If you remember, e1 has the components 1, 0, e2 has the components 0, 1. These are the vectors for the standard basis of the vector space R square, vector space R square. And you know, this vector has the components, has the entries 1, 6, can be written in this form. You know, x is equal to 1 times e1 plus 6 times e2. Instead of c1 and c2 here, c1 and c2, we have 1 and 6. So they are the coordinates of x relative to the standard basis. Actually, we know from calculus 1 and 2. This is the simplest version of this concept, since we know already. And if we consider another basis, beta, for the same vector space R square, where b1 and b2 are given here, b1 is actually e1, 1, 0, b2 is different from the second vector e2, we have 1, 2 for this. So suppose a vector x in R square has the coordinate vector, minus 2, 3. For the given basis, relative to the basis beta, these are the coordinates of the vector x relative to the basis beta in the vector space R square. So find the vector x. What are the real values? What are the real values of the vector x? Actually, we find real components, real coordinates of the vector x, not values, real components, real entries, according to the standard basis. So this is the representation of x with respect to beta, relative to the beta, basis beta, a representation of x relative to the basis beta, c1, c2, minus 2, 3. So according to the definition, x has the representation uniquely from the unique representation theorem, c1, b1 plus c2, b2. Okay, this is the definition of the coordinates of the vector x. So we know c1, which is equal to minus 2, it is given in the example, you see, and c2 is 3, and we know the vectors in the basis b1, b2, these ones, 1, 0 and 1, 2. And when we compute this operation, we obtain x has actually coordinates 1 and 6, or components 1 and 6 for the standard basis. Okay, this is the representation of the vector x according to the basis beta given in the example. This is the representation of the vector x relative to the standard basis, normal situation. Okay, according to the standard basis, you see the graphical representation of the vector x on the plane, x-axis, y-axis, namely x-axis is corresponding to the first vector of the standard basis, which is e1, has the components 1 and 0, you know, and the second vector is lying on the y-axis, 0, 1. And according to this coordinate system, x is represented graphically in this form. Okay, as you can see, the terminal point of this vector will have the coordinates 1 and 6 according to this representation. 1 and 6, as you can see. But for the bases given in the example, namely B1, B2, B1 has the components 1, 0 and B2 has the components 1, 2. B1 is the same, namely we can take the x-axis for the first coordinate. For the second coordinate, we take B2, the line whose direction vector is B2 actually. For the second axis, instead of the y-axis, we take the B2, the vector B2, namely the line whose direction vector is B2, whose direction vector is B2. Okay. Therefore, according to the new coordinate system, the graphical representation of the coordinate system will be in this form. This is the second axis. This is not vertical, as you can see, but we can represent the plane with this basis according to this coordinate system. This is the first axis. Okay, now we can say B1 axis instead of x axis. And B2 axis. This one is B2 axis. So according to this coordinate system, the vector has the components -2, 3, namely x has the representation -2 times B1 plus 3 times B2. -2 is located here for the first axis. -1 times B1, -2 times B1, which is corresponding to this point, and 3 times B2. 1 times B2, 2 times B2, and 3 times B2. And by combining the points, we obtain the terminal point of the vector x, as you can see. And this is the graphical representation of the vector x according to the basis beta. This is our new coordinate system for R-square. Okay, there is no unique representation graphically for the coordinate system of the vector space R square. You see, this is the known coordinate system we know from high school and calculus one, but this is our new coordinate system according to the basis. If you take another basis here, also you will change the graphical structure of your coordinate system for R square. Also, this is valid for every vector space like R cube, R to the 4, and so on. Okay. The angle between the axes don't need to be 90 degree. This is not 90 degree between them for the angle, okay? But we can represent every vector according to this coordinate system if we take a basis, okay? This is very important. Another example, let B1 and B2 are the vectors in R square, has the components respectively 2, 1 and -1, 1, and x is given according to the standard basis, namely we have the real representation of the vector x for 5 and beta is given here. Find the coordinate vector x beta of the vector x relative to the basis beta. Of course, first you should prove beta is a basis for R square. for R square, for the vector space R square. Okay, you can do yourselves. You will check the conditions of the basis. We have two conditions, if you remember from the previous section. So generally, since we are in R square, we will have two components for the representation of the vector x relative to the basis beta, which is written in this form, and we write c1, c2 for the coordinates. Namely, x has the representation c1, b1 plus c2, b2. Okay. We can state every vector in the vector space in terms of the vectors in the basis. Okay, the basis is the code actually of the vector space, the k-code of the vector space. So we know 4 and 5, the vector x, this vector equation will be written as 4, 5 is equal to c1 times 2, 1, c2 times minus 1, 1. We have the vector equation here. So we can state the vector equation as a matrix equation. If you remember the chapter 1, the coefficient matrix has the columns b1 and b2, as you can see, 2, 1, minus 1, 1. And the unknowns are written as a vector. And the right-hand side is the vector x according to the standard basis. So by solving this system, easily we can find the values of c1 and c2. The Aikman matrix is written here of the system. So after some row operations, we obtain the echelon form, the echelon form of this augmented matrix, as you can see. So we have pivot positions in every column, and writing the rows as linear equations written here, for example, 3 over 2 times c2 is equal to 3. The first row is corresponding to this linear equation, 2 times c1 minus c2 is equal to 4. Equal to 4, and from here we obtain c2 is equal to 2 and c1 is equal to 3. C1 is equal to 3. Therefore, the coordinates of vector x relative to the basis beta are 3 and 2, or the beta coordinates of the vector x are 3 and 2. Okay. X has representation 4, 5 according to the standard basis, or X has representation according to the basis beta 3, 2. Okay. When we change the basis of the vector space, also the coordinates of every vector will change, as you can see. So let beta be a basis for a vector space R to the n, b, and it includes the vectors b1, b2, blah blah, bn. So any vector x in Rn, any vector x in Rn has the representation written here, which is a linear combination of the vectors in the basis, as you can see. And we know c1, c2, blah blah, cn are the coordinates of vector x. You know, you see the representation of the vector x relative to the basis beta in matrix notation, c1, c2, blah blah, cn according to the basis beta. So this vector equation also can be stated in matrix equation. This is corresponding to the matrix equation written here. The left hand side is the vector x, and we consider a matrix whose columns are the vectors b1, b2, blah blah, bn, which is denoted by p beta, and you see the columns. And we write also the matrix notation of the coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta, and we find a matrix equation for this linear representation for the vector x. Okay, so this is matrix representation. This is the representation of x in matrix notation. And the matrix P beta is called the change of coordinate matrix. Change of coordinate matrix. And the left multiplication by the inverse of P beta, how can we understand it is invertible? The change of coordinate matrix is invertible. So we can understand this matrix is invertible from the definition of the basis, because the columns of the matrix P beta are the vectors in the basis, and we have two conditions for the basis. If you remember, the vectors should be linearly independent, which means that if we create a matrix by using these vectors, so since the columns are linearly independent, then we have pivot position in every column. All of them are pivot columns. So by invertible matrix theorem, we can say that it is invertible. Because of the first condition of the basis, this matrix P beta is invertible. Therefore, we can multiply this matrix equation by the inverse of the matrix P beta. Okay, so transforms the coordinate vector into x, namely we eliminate the representation of x relative to the basis written here by multiplying this matrix equation by the inverse of P beta. Namely, we write the inverse of P beta times x left multiplication. We multiply from the left side, and we have the inverse of P beta times P beta times x, and this becomes identity matrix. Here we have x beta. Therefore, x beta, namely the coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta, can be found by finding this multiplication, matrix multiplication. First, we will find the inverse of the matrix P beta, and we multiply this matrix by the vector x, the representation of the vector x according to the standard basis. And this equality can be stated also as a transformation, namely T of x, namely we take T of x as x beta, which is equal to the inverse of P times x. Okay, we create a transformation, and this is a linear transformation because this is a matrix transformation. Already we have the standard matrix of this transformation, if you remember, which is the inverse of the matrix P beta according to the definition written here. So the correspondence, namely this transformation, linear transformation, is called the coordinate mapping, which is one-to-one linear transformation. It is also one-to-one because the standard matrix of this transformation is invertible, namely all columns are linearly independent. Therefore, it is one-to-one. Okay. For example, beta be the standard base of the vector space P cube of polynomials, which is the set of all polynomials of degree at most 3, if you remember. And the general structure, the general representation of a vector in this vector space can be given in this form. You see, a0 plus a1t plus a2t squared plus a3t to the power 3, where the coefficients are real numbers of the polynomial. And we know its standard basis from the previous section, 4.3. The basis includes the vectors 1, t, t squared, and t to the power 3. So we define a transformation, actually the a mapping from the vector space P cube and R to the 4. We have two different vector spaces, as you can see, in the domain and in the codomain. The domain of the transformation is the set of all polynomials of degree at most 3, and the codomain of this transformation is the vector space R to the 4. So when we take an arbitrary vector from the domain, which is a polynomial, its image under T will be a vector in R to the 4 whose coordinates, whose components are a0, a1, a2, and a3. So it is a linear transformation, or according to the standard basis, this is the representation of the vector P, actually, in matrix notation, and it is written in this form, as you can see, P of T beta, because this polynomial is actually a linear combination of the vectors written here. If we say B1 is 1, B2 is T, B3 is T squared, and B4 is t to the power 3, okay, t to the power 3. Therefore, the vector P can be written as a linear combination of them, as a0, b1, a1, b2, a2, b3, and a3, b4. Therefore, in matrix notation, the coordinates of this vector can be written in this form. Therefore, this is the representation of the polynomial of with respect to the standard basis beta. So we can easily see this is a linear transformation. If you remember the properties of the linear transformation, the first property says that the image of addition of two vectors under T is actually the addition of the images of P1 and P2 under T. As you can see, P1 has the representation written here, P2 has another one according to the definition of the vector space, and P1 plus P2 will be this representation. We will use the coefficients of the polynomials to apply the sum of two polynomials, if you remember. And the image of this addition of two polynomials under T will be this one, according to the definition written here. This is obtained from here. And a0, b0, a1, b1, a2, b2, and a3, b3 are numbers. Therefore, we can state this term as addition of two vectors, as you can see, according to the terms in the entries, a0, a1, a2, and a3, b0, b0, b1, b2 and b3. And therefore we have t of p1 plus t of p2, which means that the first property is satisfied. The second property says that the image of r times p, where r is a real number, is equal to r times t of p. We can write r outside of this parenthesis. So r times p will be this one, you know, and the image of this vector, namely polynomial, will be this representation written here, and we can write the real number r in front of the matrix notation of this vector, as you can see. So this is equal to r times t of p. Namely, we obtain this equality. We have the second condition. Therefore, the given transformation is a linear transformation. So using this transformation, we can say that the vector spaces have the same properties actually, because we can transform this vector space into this vector space actually by using this transformation, because for every vector in one of them we have a representation for the other. The polynomial corresponds to a vector in R to the 4. Therefore, we can consider they state the same vector space by the linear transformation. We have the same properties for them, mostly. For example, use coordinate vectors to verify that the polynomials p1, p2, and p3 are linearly dependent in P2, which is the set of all polynomials of degree at most 2. So how can we find these vectors, namely polynomials, are linearly dependent? According to this concept, this result, the correspondence will be this one, namely the set of all polynomials of degree at most 2 is equivalent to the vector space R3, For example, when we take any arbitrary polynomial from the first vector space, which is written as a0 plus a1t plus a2 times t squared. So the representation of this vector in this vector space R3 will be written as a0, a1, a2. We use the coefficients of the polynomial. Okay, this is the representation of the vector relative to the basis beta of vector space P2. So the representation of the polynomials will be these ones, okay, according to this concept, 1, 0, 2, which are the coefficients of the polynomial P1. You see, 1, 0, 2, the coefficient of T is 0. P2 has the components 4, 1, 5. And P3 has the components 3, 2, 0. Namely, we have actually 0 times t squared. Therefore, to determine whether these vectors are linearly independent, so we will write them in a matrix as the columns, as you can see, P1. Is the first column, P2 is the second column, and P3 is the third column. And after row operations, we obtain its echelon form, And we see in the first and second column we have pivot positions, but in the third column we don't have. Therefore, V1, V2, and V3 are linearly dependent since we don't have pivot position in the third column. Therefore, the corresponding polynomials, namely P1, P2, and P3, are linearly independent, and you see the linear dependence relation, linear dependence relation. How can we obtain this relation? So we consider the homogeneous system by adding the last column. And the second row corresponds to C2 plus 2 times C3 is equal to 0. By the way, C1 and C2 are basic variables. C3 is free. Is a free variable. So from the second row we obtain C2 plus 2 times C3 is equal to 0. From the first row we obtain C1 plus 4 times C2 plus 3 times C3 is equal to 0. And since C3 is free variable, we write the basic variables in terms of the free variable. C1 becomes minus 2 times C3, and from here, C1 becomes, so C2 is minus 2 times C3 times 4 minus 8 times C3 plus 3 times C3 becomes minus 5 times C3, writing to the right hand side, we obtain plus 5 times C3. And the solution vector will have the representation 5 C3 minus 2 times C3, which is C2 and C3. So writing 1 for C3, writing 1 for C3, for example, so C2 becomes minus 2, C1 becomes 5. Therefore, we have actually 5 times V1. Plus minus 2 times V2 plus V3 is equal to the 0 vector, or we can write V3 in this form. Okay, writing them to the right hand side, we can obtain this dependence relation, which means that they are linearly dependent. So the same dependence can be stated for the polynomials. Instead of V3, we write P3. Okay, V3 is corresponding to P3. 2 times P2 minus 5 times P1. You can check writing the definitions of the polynomials. Another example. V1 and V2 are given here in R3. And x has the representation 3, 12, and 7. Beta contains the vectors v1 and v2. Then beta is a basis for the subspace H, which is the set spanned by the vectors v1 and v2. Okay, because v1 and v2 are linearly independent, one of them is not a multiple of the other. You can check. So determine whether x is in H. X is in H. Namely, we should determine whether X is a vector in this subspace or not, and if it is, find the coordinate vector of X according to the basis beta. So to say that X is a vector for this subspace, which is the set spanned by the vectors v1 and v2, so we should write X as a linear combinations of them, which means that this vector equation can be written in matrix equation like this: c1 times v1, c2 times v2, and the vector X. The corresponding Eichmann matrix will be this one. And after row operations, we obtain the echelon form of the Eichmann matrix like this. And from here we obtain using the second row, C2 is 3. And using the first row, C1 is 2. So the system is consistent, which means that X is in the subspace. And X is equal to, so the second question of this example is to find the coordinate vector of X according to the basis beta, and X is a vector in R³, actually in R³, namely we should obtain three components for X. But for the subspace H, you know, in the basis we have two vectors, P beta has the columns v1 and v2, 3, 6, 2, minus 0, 1, and our aim is to find the representation of the vector X according to the basis beta, written here, and we know the vector X, the components of the vector X, but already we obtained the representation of the vector X according to the basis beta, because we know the weights, which are C1 and C2 actually. Therefore, the representation of X relative to the basis beta will be 2, 3. This is the coordinate vector in the subspace H. As you can see, the subspace is spanned by the vectors v1 and v2, and the basis of this subspace contains the vectors v1 and v2. Namely, we have two vectors here, two vectors. The number of vectors here is 2. Therefore, the number of entries, the number of coordinates for this vector will be 2. We have 2 coordinates. So the number of coordinates of a vector is equal to the number of vectors in the basis for each vector in the vector space. Okay. So a vector in R³ becomes a vector in H. In H, actually this is a vector in the plane. Okay. By the coordinate mapping, this is the vector in space, three-dimensional space. This is a vector in two-dimensional space. Also, we will see the definition of dimension of a vector space in the next section. Another example, let b1, b2, b3 are given here, 1, 0, 0, minus 3, 4, 0, 3, minus 6, 3, and X has the representation relative to the standard basis minus 8 to 3. The first question show that the set beta, including the vectors b1, b2, b3, is a basis of R³. Find the change of coordinate matrix, which is the second question, from beta to standard basis of R³. Write the equation that relates x in R³ to the representation of vector x relative to the basis beta, namely the matrix equation, if you remember, and find the coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta given in the example. It may be, for example, a final exam question. So we know that the vectors in the basis create a matrix, as you can see, 1, 0, 0, minus 3, 4, 0, 3, -6, 3. So this is actually represented by, denoted by p beta. If the vectors b1, b2, b3 represents a basis for the vector space. So how can we understand? Of course, we will find the echelon form of this matrix, and if we have pivot positions in every column, as you can see, after row operations, we have pivot positions in every column. This is the echelon form. Namely, we will find the echelon form of this matrix to see clearly, exactly, whether we have a pivot position or not for each column. So from here we say that beta is linearly independent, which means that we have the first condition, and beta spans R³ by the invertible matrix theorem, because A is invertible, if you remember. For example, when we take any arbitrary vector from the vector space R³, for example y, so y should be a linear combination of the vectors c1 b1 plus c2 b2 plus c3 b3, or in matrix notation we write p beta times c, the vector c. And since this matrix is invertible, so we have a solution for this matrix equation. C is actually the inverse of the matrix times y. Namely, for each vector y we have at least one solution, which means that every vector in the vector space can be represented as a linear combination of the vectors in the set beta, which means that every vector in the vector space is actually a vector in the set spanned by these vectors. Therefore, beta spans R³. Which means that we have the second condition. Therefore, beta is a basis for R³. This is the answer of the first question. The second question, find the change of coordinate matrix. This is the matrix P beta, you know, as you can see. And the third question, write the equation that relates x in R³ to representation of x, coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta. And I wrote this matrix equation, you know, this one. By using this equation, we can find the coordinate vector of x relative to the basis beta, which is actually the answer of the last question, as you can see. For finding this vector, of course, we will find a column form of this a column form of the matrix of this matrix equation, linear system. So after row operations, we obtain the echelon form, as you can see. And we find directly the representation of x relative to the basis beta. Namely, x has the coordinates minus 5, 2, and 1 according to the relative to basis beta. Namely, the given vector at the beginning has the components minus 8 to 3 becomes minus 5 to 1. Minus 5 to 1. Okay, this is the representation of x according to the beta. This is the representation of x according to the standard basis epsilon. Okay, thank you very much for your listening.